just looking at something I'd written in my Bible years ago, and it's relevant for today. And what I had written was that our job as the body of Christ, which is God's delegated authority, is to destroy the works of the devil. So to close this distance between the invisible reality of God's kingdom and the unredeemed reality of our circumstances. The inferior reality of our circumstances always yields to the superior reality of the kingdom. But we can only release the kingdom to the degree that our hearts and minds are in agreement with it.
Yes.
Which speaks of our declarations and our minds being renewed to the Word of God. So that when we're confronted with the seen and the unseen, or the devil's agenda versus God's agenda, mm-hmm. we prove God can trust us with more of the kingdom, with more revelation, with more manifestation, or we get bitter and doubt God and become anxious and disappointed. That has never changed. That'll always be the case. We have, an invisible reality, which is the kingdom of God, and then we have a unredeemed reality, which is our circumstances, which is what we face in the natural realm every day, all day long. And God wants to give us more manifestation of that unseen realm.
Amen.
But the only way that happens, and the reason for our declarations, is not just a rote, repetitious kind of action, but a way of disciplining our minds to speak to things that are as though they were not, and to things that are not as though they were. And everybody has a natural reality, a circumstantial reality, if you will. And the way that changes is by manifestation of the kingdom.
Right.
Or you could even say a manifestation of God, because any manifestation of the kingdom is a manifestation of God, whether it's healing, whether it's deliverance, financial breakthrough, relationships restored, all of those things are part and parcel of God's purpose and promises to us. So we can't, sometimes we need to remind ourselves that it's the simple things, the constant things in our lives, spiritually speaking, that actually change the circumstances and situations. And those constants need to be in agreement with the Word of God. So we never can declare too much the promises of God and the Word of God into circumstances, because it's our natural tendency to always degrade or always go back to the natural. It's just too easy as humans to just say what we see,
right.
Repeat what it is that's happening to us. But that's what separates us from the lower forms of life, to be quite honest with you,
right.
Is that we are able to actually transcend the natural realm through our authority in Jesus' name, by declaring our authority in this realm. That's what the scripture talks about. God created man in his own image and gave him dominion. When we were redeemed, in the New Testament, the scripture says, because by his grace, we become inheritors, and then we reign in life by one, Jesus Christ, meaning we again rule and do what was originally done in Adam, which is have dominion.
Mm-hmm.
In order to reign, you have to have a dominion to reign over.
Amen.
And our dominion is wherever we set our foot, the same as it was for Abraham and his progeny, which by faith is us. So
yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's not just repeat these declarations. Let's speak them from our heart, so that we can get the manifestation that God intends for each and every one of us. Amen?
Amen.
Any prayer requests? Yes, Roberto.
I have to keep reminding myself that what God says He's going to do in my life, He's going to do it. Sometimes I get a little anxious because I might not be seeing a result for something that I specifically want to really happen. And my wife and I have been together for 14 years, but this past year has seemed to be longer than those 14 years combined. And as you were saying what you were saying, it reminded me of Habakkuk chapter 2, when he said, "The Lord answered me, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, so he may run who reads it. For still the vision awaits its appointed time. It hastens to the end, it will not lie. If it seems slow, wait for it. It will surely come, it will not delay. I know that God is going to give me what He promised me. I just have to make sure that I don't get anxious and try to make things happen on my own, because that's not what He wants. He wants me to trust Him, and I do. And it's really hard being here by myself. You guys are like my family, but sometimes I feel really, really lonely in here, because I don't have anyone here that is related to me, my blood. But I know that God's with me all the time.
Amen.
That's right. You know, I talked about, I don't know how long ago, a year or 2 years ago or something, about the different dimensions, you know, as dogs, animals of that nature basically are two-dimensional. They live in a two-dimensional world. Humans naturally live in a three-dimensional world, which is what makes our perceptions and so on and so forth more complex than the animal kingdom. But there is a fourth dimension, and that's the kingdom dimension, the kingdom of God.
Right.
And what I was talking about just a couple of minutes ago is what we call coincidence is actually two incidents that collide or come together, or two dimensions that conflict or come together. And that's what you're dealing with. You have the natural incidents of what is actually happening in the natural realm, and then the promises of God, which God declares to be the reality or the actual incident. So you have two different incidences coming together, and it becomes a coincidence. And it's how and what that brings is revelation. What it's supposed to bring is revelation. In other words, your expectation of God becomes greater when there's a greater need. God becomes bigger. That's the way it's supposed to be. You know, He's supposed to get bigger in every circumstance that we're confronted with, not shrunk down, but actually become bigger than the circumstance and the situation. And that's what you're declaring. Even though in the natural, there's all these other emotions going on, which are natural. There's nothing wrong with that. That would be expected. But we don't go by those feelings. We still live our life based on the greater reality, the fourth dimension, rather than just the third dimension. And so what you have is a revelation, but the bottom line is the way we respond to revelation is what the revelation will produce.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you have a revelation of God in this circumstance and in this situation, that God is greater than that circumstance.
Right.
Your belief in that relation is what that revelation will produce. That's the way the kingdom works. That's why we can't deviate based, again, on those circumstances and situations. We have to discipline ourselves, spiritually speaking.
Mm-hmm.
It's not denial. It's not denial of the reality of the natural fact, but it's a belief in a greater truth, a truth that's greater than whatever the fact, the natural fact is. For example, if you're sick in your body, that's a fact. And the doctors will give you natural, you know, evidence of that and confirm the natural fact that's going on. But we believe in a truth that's greater than that fact, the truth being that by his stripes we're healed.
Amen.
That's a revelation. Many people, Christians included, don't have a revelation of that. They don't believe in divine healing. They're just, you know, they're just hanging out there with everybody else.
Yep.
But the manifestation of that revelation is the result of your believing the revelation.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, it can't happen if you don't believe it.
If
you don't have, if God gives you a revelation of that and then you don't respond in a positive way to that revelation, it doesn't manifest. You can call it faith. You can call it whatever you want to, but from an intellectual perspective, it's simply agreeing with that revelation. That's what changes circumstances. Abraham believed God. The circumstance in his relationship and his lack of children, it didn't change for years.
Right.
And yet he continued to believe in the revelation that God had given him, that he would be the father of many nations, a multitude.
Yes.
So it was his agreement with this revelation, you can say, that produced the result,
mm-hmm.
or the fulfillment of that revelation.
Mm-hmm.
And in a very simple or fundamental way, that's true of everything in the kingdom of God. We call it faith, but that's what it is. It's simply coming into an agreement with what God has said above the circumstance, whatever it might be.
Amen.
And it doesn't matter whether it's people, inanimate objects, whatever, you know, physical issues, financial, it all works the same way.
Mm-hmm.
It's the way God intended it. It's the way he set it up. So you could say this is just a coincidence. You know, you have an incident and an incident, a supernatural and a natural. They collide.
Hallelujah.
The supernatural is always greater than the natural.
Yes. Yes.
Nothing happens here except that it comes out of that other dimension. It has to come from the other dimension before it can exist in this dimension. That's true of everything that we're looking at.
Amen.
So it's true in the kingdom.
Hallelujah.
It's a principle that's established in natural science, but it's a reality that comes from the supernatural.
Yes.
And it's taken science several thousand years to figure out what God was doing from the very beginning.
Uh-huh.
He looked at things that were not and spoke from that invisible world, and it produced a physical, natural reality.
Amen.
And we're doing the same thing. We were created in his image and in his likeness, and he expects us then to operate from that likeness and from that image, that reality. Praise the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Hallelujah. Any other prayer requests? Yeah, Mike.
We pray for co-worker Tony. They got him out of ICU, CU, and then ICU, and they moved him into a regular room. He isn't able to talk yet because they're going to do a tracheostomy or whatever else and stuff like that. I'm still praying for him, naturally for his healing, but also for that visitation from the Lord. Give him a wake-up call, I guess you might want to call it.
Yeah.
I'll be able to finally go see him. I'm hoping tomorrow night, and just pray for God's favor and anointing for going in and working with this transformation that I believe God wants to do.
Amen. We'll believe with you. Anyone else? Yeah, John.
Yeah, I took Evelyn to the doctor today, so she, they had issues and problems.
Amen. Anybody else? pray for Tammy's situation there with the water and the whole mess. Just as I said, you know, these things all work together. I mean, whether it's a physical, you know, structural issue or a building, you know, or our bodies, God is able. He's bigger than all of these things.
Amen.
So, amen. Why don't we stand and go to the Lord in prayer right now? Let's just believe God for all of these. These are not big things to God. They just seem big to us.
Amen.
But we're looking at the natural realm, and we respond to it. But God is greater than any circumstance, any situation, any individual, any groups of people. God is greater. He is the author and the finisher of our faith. So we have the faith to believe. We just put our confidence in Him, and that's what we're going to do right now. For every situation mentioned here tonight, for every circumstance, for every individual, no matter what it is, how great it might seem, God is greater. And so, Father, we come to You with great confidence because we know in Your Word, You told us that if we come to You with anything that's in Your will, then we know that You hear us. And if You hear us, we know that we have our petition. So we thank You right now, Lord, for the finished work of the cross. We thank You that we are more than conquerors in every situation and every circumstance. We thank You, Lord, and we come into agreement with Your Word that Your Word is the final word. In every situation, no matter how dark it might seem here, You are the light, and that light shines in the darkness and releases the Almighty God, a supernatural circumstance, a miracle, are natural for You, Lord, because You are greater than all the natural. It becomes supernatural. We believe You right now, Lord, for healing, for deliverance, for restoration, for breakthrough in every area. Become great, Lord. Become greater. Show Yourself mighty on our behalf. And we'll be sure to give You all the praise and all the glory, Lord, not only now but throughout eternity. We bless Your name and praise You. You are a great and a mighty God. You are a good God. And if You've given us the most precious thing that You have, Your life in Christ, then there's nothing, no thing that You will not give us. So we receive our answer right now by faith. And we praise You for the manifestation. In the mighty and the matchless name of Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. All right, what do we got? Any announcements? No announcements? All right. Let's confess. And declare, hallelujah. Will You not revive us again, that Your people may rejoice in You? Praise God. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Praise God. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ, every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. Praise God. I receive the spirit of revelation, wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I'm not conformed to this world, but I'm transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Thank You, Jesus. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that's formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Thank You, Jesus. Praise God. John, would you come and take up the offering for us, please?
Thank You, Lord.
Jesus' name. God bless you. Let's worship the Lord like there were thousands.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord. Got to listen to the DVD from Sunday when we did a cappella in the room, and I still heard extra voices, so I can't blame it on the sound system when these things happen. So I thank the Lord. I thank the Lord. I thank you for the faithful servants that are here and that were here at that time also. Blessings, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Just dwell in his presence. Just dwell in his presence. For you are the one we want to meet. Jesus, shine through all the praises that we sing. For you are the one we want to meet. Jesus, shine through all the praises that we sing. We sing, come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. Come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. Come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. For you are the one we want to meet. Shine through all the praises that we sing. 'Cause we have come to give you highest praise, highest praise. We have come to love you in this place. We have come to give you highest praise, highest praise. We have come to love you in this place. For you are the one we want to meet. Jesus, shine through all the praises that we sing. It's all for you. presence. Fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. Come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord, is all I need, is all I want, is all there is. For your glory, be lifted high, be lifted high, be lifted high. For your glory, be lifted and the 24 elders casting their crowns, singing, be lifted high, be lifted high. For your glory, be lifted high, be lifted high, be lifted high. For your glory, be lifted high. You are weary and you're tired of the battle that has been raging. Just relax in the Lord. Just rest in Him. Give the battle to Him. He is the strength. He is your shield. He says, come to me. You who are in need of rest. Return to me. Return to me, you who are in need of strength. Don't be weary in well doing, so come to me. Burden down. heaviness down, so come to me. Return to me. Rest in me. Come to me. Come to me. You who are in need of rest, return to me. You who are in need of strength, come to me. You who are in need of rest, return to me. You who are in need of strength. 'Cause I love Jesus. I love your presence. I love your presence. I love you, Jesus. In the glory of your presence, I find rest for my tired and weary soul. In the depth of your I find peace, makes me whole. I love your presence. I love your
Thank you for your presence. You gave us your spirit. You said this was the refreshing wherewith the weary would be refreshed. Lord, whenever we turn in to your spirit, whenever we look to you, we are refreshed, restored, and renewed. Even as the eagles, yes. He said we could rise up on eagles' wings.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
The weary would not faint, but be renewed,
yes, Lord,
in the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
And we look to you, Lord, the author, yes, Lord, and finisher of our faith, our strength. The lifter up of our head.
Yes.
As we behold you, Lord, are strengthened and renewed. You said you'd never leave us or forsake us. And we know, Lord, that wherever you are, miracles happen.
Yes, Lord.
Life comes.
Yes, Lord.
Strength comes.
Yes,
Lord. Renewal in every area, Lord. We declare that to be our reality, Lord.
Yes.
The joy of the Lord is our strength. We will rejoice in you, Lord, and be strengthened.
Yes.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. God bless you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank the Lord. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Well, I want to move quickly tonight because I've got a lot of scripture here, and I would like to get through it tonight. But I want to talk to you about, I caught a little bit of a program this afternoon, and speaking of kind of the two covenants. But I want to try to explain some things this evening that I think would help us. You know, the Bible says that God is love. It doesn't say that that's an attribute, but that's who he is. That's what he is. For God so loved that he gave. And I think a lot of times when we look at the Old Testament, we see a different God than the one that we recognize in Jesus. And that's not that's not true. It's not right. And one of the reasons is because of the way we approach the Old Testament. And I'd like us to, as we grow in our relationship with the Lord, to learn to approach the Old Testament just like we do the New Testament, with the same expectation of God's grace, his goodness, his love. There should be no deviation there. Now, I understand the law and legalism and so on and so forth, but I think there's something that God tries to show us from the very beginning, and that's his true nature. His true nature is to love and to give grace, and that's true of the Old Testament as well as in the New Testament. So let's begin with John chapter 14, verses 7 through 9. And I just, we'll talk about some things tonight. The prophets of the Old Testament, they prophesied of Jesus. They prophesied of grace. And there was grace available. Has always been grace available. But the understanding of that was limited. So you might say there was lesser grace in the Old Testament and greater grace in the New Testament. But the truth is God always wanted to extend grace and show his love and his mercy towards his creation and towards humanity specifically. But we misunderstand that, even as the Jews did, and partly it's because even though we look at the Pharisees and Sadducees and so forth, and we think how foolish that they didn't see Jesus, but it wasn't because they didn't have opportunities, it was because of the manipulation and the perversion of the scripture. Now, we could say the same thing about the New Testament. The gospel was preached in the Old Testament. It was preached to Abraham. It was preached to Moses. God said it. He had to have it. And it had to be the same gospel, or else it would have been, if it wasn't the same gospel, then God would have been schizophrenic and his message would have been distorted. Well, it was distorted, but it was distorted by man. The purpose that God had for it was pure. And that's what I'd like to show you a little bit about tonight. That way we can understand and believe that there's no schism, there's no division, there's no difference between Jesus and God the Father. And I mean that in terms of his way he relates to us. All right? So John 14, beginning at verse 7, "If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth ye know him and have seen him. Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Jesus said unto him, Have I been so long with time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, Show us the Father?" So Jesus himself is telling us, now I know we've all heard these scriptures over and over, but there's still a stigma, there's still this attitude about the God of the Old Testament being different than Jesus. And Jesus clearly says, there's no difference.
Right.
What you're seeing me do, you're seeing me react to people, respond to people, reach out to people, this is the Father. This is what the Father does. This is who the Father is, okay? So now let's go to Luke chapter 24 and verse 27. "And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." Now this is the Emmaus Road encounter. And it says that beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Praise the Lord. Now, one more scripture, Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. "But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law." Now, there's been a lot of debate about this. I've questioned it. I've wondered and prayed about it and studied on it and everything else. But I believe what's happening here is the fullness of time was come. That was when the prophecies, all the prophecies, all that the prophets of the Old Testament had prophesied, there came a point where all of this would come together, where it would be revealed perfectly. Mm-hmm. That's what he's talking about, the fullness of time. It's also what I was talking about here a few nights ago about the fullness of time for this end time revival. Mm-hmm. As revelation and the prophecies that have gone forth over our personal lives, over the church collectively, there comes a point where the prophecies are understood. It's like I was talking about revelation. To the extent that you understand the revelation and agree with the revelation is the extent to which that revelation will then manifest. So we have information, but it isn't always revelation. And the reason I know that it isn't always revelation, just because we understand it intellectually, is because we're not seeing manifestation. Now, we may see some manifestation in individuals, but I'm talking about in corporate bodies like this particular church and so on and so forth. So there is a fullness of time for everything. And the end times, the last day revival, there'll be a fullness of time, and I believe we'll be a part of that. So now, that's key to everything we need to understand. It isn't that God wasn't talking about these things in the Old Testament, but it wasn't the context wasn't such that the people could understand it completely.
Right?
So let's go back to Luke 24, verse 27, and we'll start from there. And I'll try to move quickly. "Beginning at Moses and all the prophets, Jesus expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." Now that's powerful, because Jesus used New Testament light to interpret Old Testament scripture. The gospel will interpret the Old Testament by showing us its goal and its meaning. In other words, the gospel of grace, the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, is everywhere in the Old Testament, but it's only there when you approach it from the gospel, mm-hmm. from that truth. Mm-hmm. If you don't have that truth, then when you look at the Old Testament, you see all sorts of other stuff.
Right.
All right? But Jesus said, the Old Testament, all the prophets, Moses, and in all the scripture,
right.
was talking about him.
Right.
right? So he called this Emmaus Road sermon, the things concerning himself.
Right.
Moses, all the prophets, all the scripture, right? Talking about his sufferings and his glory. So the whole Old Testament was about him, specifically about his sufferings and his glory.
Yes.
In other words, the crucifixion, death, burial, resurrection, so on, and then the resurrection, the glory. Amen. All right, look at John chapter 8, verse 56. Now, what I want you to see, too, is that these apostles understood that. That's what they were preaching. That's how they preached it. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad.
Yeah.
That's Jesus. He said, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Amen?
Yeah.
So, get this out of your mind that Abram only had this kind of vague comprehension and he just knew God, you know, like the one God.
Right.
That's not what Jesus is saying. He says Abraham had more than a general belief in God. He had a Messiah-centered faith.
Yes.
Amen?
Right.
So when did Abraham see Jesus' day with joy? Well, Jesus doesn't answer the question here in John chapter 8, but years later, when the Apostle Paul is baptized in the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of Christ, he begins to teach, and we get more details. Paul refers to God's promise to Abraham in Genesis 12. Now, we won't go there, but you can go back and check this later, but Genesis 12 is where God calls Abram out of Ur of the Chaldees and tells him he's going to bless him and he's going to be a blessing, and so forth. Right? All right. Now, Paul refers to all of this in Galatians chapter 3, verse 8. Let's look at that. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So he was preaching the gospel.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Amen? Abraham was being told the world-blessing Redeemer will come, and he's going to come through your family.
Yes.
That's why Paul could say that God preached the gospel to Abraham.
Yes.
Now, in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, that's where this comes from. He says, you're going to be blessed, and you'll be a blessing, and so forth. Now, it wasn't the whole gospel. But on top of Genesis 3:15, which is where God tells men that the seed of the woman and the seed of Satan will have warfare, and the seed of Satan will bruise the heel of the seed of the woman, but the seed of the woman will crush his head.
Right.
So mix that, when you take that and mix it with Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, now, amen, it was enough of the gospel to enable Abraham to obey God's call by faith and to see Christ's day by faith and be glad.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. But when that day finally came, both Mary and Zacharias rejoiced in it. Remember in the temple?
Yep.
And that was the fulfillment to the promise that was given to Abraham.
Yes. Yes.
You'll see my day and rejoice. The promise was being fulfilled. Amen. So Paul presents Abraham as the prototype and the example of saving faith.
Yes.
Now, if we believe different gospels, in other words, if Abraham's gospel was different than the gospel that we have, then it's counterproductive.
That's right.
So we all believe the same gospel. The vocabulary is a little bit different. The clarity is different because it was back then, pre-incarnation, right?
Mm-hmm.
Abraham believed in the shadows, in the types, in the symbols.
Yep.
We, in the sunlight, believed, you know, as a result of history to some extent. But even though the directions are different, in other words, Abraham believed
forward. He believed for an event that had not yet happened.
Yes.
We believe backward in a sense because we look back to what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. But the core, the essence, or the focus is exactly the same. Mm-hmm. Amen. Now, his faith wrapped itself around the promised Satan-crushing, world-blessing, life-giving seed of the woman. The same as ours does. Mm-hmm. And the result is also the same.
Yes.
He believed in the Lord, and God, or the Lord, accounted it to him for righteousness.
Thank you, Lord.
Same message, same gospel. And it works the same way.
Yes.
Now, look at John chapter 5, verses 39 through 47. Rather lengthy here, but it's worth getting this in the context. John 5, 39 through 47. Now, I want you to know the love of the Father. It's hard for us to have this Abba kind of relationship with God because we still have this distorted view. You know, we can approach Jesus, but we still feel like, you know, well, but God's still got a temper. He's got an attitude, you know. But here Jesus says, search the scriptures, for in them you think ye have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me. And ye will not come to me that ye might have life. I receive not honor from men, but I know you, that ye have not the love of God in you. Now listen about this. Listen to this. It's not the love for God that they're lacking. They don't have an understanding of the love of God that's in them, that has come to them. And it's true of the church today.
Yes.
If we really understood the love that God has for us, we'd be rejoicing.
Yeah.
We'd be at peace. We'd have a greater expectation that God's going to do for us whatever he said he would do because he loves us so much.
Yes.
But this conflict between Old Testament and New Testament, the misunderstandings of it, keeps God off in the distance as some kind of angry thing and Jesus as somewhat approachable, you know. When in fact they're the same.
Yep.
So I'm come in my Father's name and you receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him you will receive. How can ye believe which receive honor of one another and seek not the honor that cometh from God only? Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom ye trust. For had ye believed Moses, get this, for had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me. For he wrote of me, Moses. But if you believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words? Now he's saying something here that has got to be confounding to these Jews. Because
right.
They're thinking, we got two different messages happening here. We got this guy, this Johnny coming along saying God loves you and just come to Jesus and praise the Lord and everything will be wonderful. And then we got Moses telling us, you know, God's going to get you. It was their understanding. It wasn't what Moses preached. It was the way they understood what Moses preached because Jesus said he preached me.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Jesus said the Old Testament scripture testifies of me. Moses wrote about me.
Yes.
Believing Moses and what Moses taught is the same as believing me. Amen. Mm-hmm. So what's the Old Testament all about? Jesus answered him. Me. I mean, Moses wrote the first five books. All right, let's go to 1 Peter. I'm going to show you the apostles understood this. After the resurrection, they were in agreement with what Jesus is teaching here. So in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 10 through 12. Of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. Unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. Amen. So the prophet's questions here were more about the exact timing and the specific circumstances of this fulfillment. They knew what the prophecies were. They knew what it was about. They knew about Jesus. They knew about the Messiah. Their main, what they were searching into was when. What will be the time that this happens? What will be the exact circumstances surrounding Israel when this fulfillment of the prophecy, when this fullness of time happens? Amen? So, these verses in Peter tells us that the prophets knew these things. They knew that Jesus would come. Why? Because what is Jesus' name? God saves. God saves. That's the nature of God.
Yes.
He's the Savior.
Yes.
Amen? Jesus is the Savior. Okay. And Jesus would suffer. Mm-hmm. And that Jesus would be glorified. They knew this. Prophets of the Old Testament knew this.
Yes.
Jesus was, what is the Messiah? What is Christ? It's the anointed one or the sent one.
Mm-hmm.
The one that they knew was coming. Okay, so the prophets didn't have a comprehensive, you could say, or a complete knowledge of Jesus, but then who does? Even now. But they knew enough to answer the who question. Praise the Lord. Their major questions were about the where and the when. Verse 12. Unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us, they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. So, what they're saying was this, we understand it, but it'll be better understood by future generations. We know who, we just don't know the details, but future generations will know more of those details because they'll be there to experience it. So in Galatians chapter 3 and 4, when we read that, and I've done this myself, but the more I've studied it, it looks like Paul's view of the Old Testament, especially the Old Testament law, is really negative. But when you study these chapters in light of Christ in the Old Testament, the focus that I'm trying to get us to tonight, Paul's making a distinction between the Old Testament as rightly understood, and Old Testament as warped and perverted by Judaizers and legalists. He's saying there's nothing wrong with the Old Testament, but it's the perception and the teaching that the Judaizers and the Pharisaical kind of minds presented. So Paul wasn't negative about the Old Testament the way it was designed by God, but he was upset and negative about the Old Testament as it had been perverted by man.
Right.
We could say the same thing about the New Testament today.
Mm-hmm.
We have an understanding and an approach to God and an acceptance of His favor and His grace that many people in the New Testament don't have. Not because it's not true, but because of the way it's presented.
Yes.
Same thing with the Old Testament. So Paul wasn't negative about it. He was negative about the way it had been perverted.
Right.
And if anybody knew the difference, it was Paul,
yep,
who was the apostle of grace, and also who had been Paul, the persecutor of grace.
Right.
He'd seen both sides.
Yep.
Amen? And here's the background then to these two chapters. And we're pretty familiar with this, but let me just go over it a little bit just to make it a little bit clear in the context of what I'm trying to teach tonight. So through this Christ-centered teaching and the preaching of Paul, these Galatians had been delivered from the bondage of trying to please God or to get saved or to get to heaven by obeying the Ten Commandments and following ceremonial law. Paul preached a Jesus who had obeyed the moral law for sinners. A Jesus who had suffered the penalty of the law broken by sinners. And a Jesus who had abolished the rituals and the ceremonies by fulfilling them. They were symbols. They were types. And many of the Galatians believed in this Jesus. The yoke of bondage was smashed.
Yes.
The prison doors were opened.
Yes.
And the chains fell off. That's the metaphors that Paul uses. They entered a new world of freedom and liberty. Now, who's going to give that up? The Galatians.
Yeah.
I mean, it's insane. They allowed false teachers, Paul says, from Jewish synagogues to persuade them that faith in Jesus was not enough. They needed to be circumcised. They needed to follow ceremonial rituals. And so, turning away from Jesus, they put their necks under a heavy yoke again and back into chains.
Yes.
Amen. Now, in Galatians chapter 4, let's look at verse 21. This God that created us, that created everything, He's a God of love. He loves us. Tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, do you not hear the law? Now get this. Now, I'm telling you, that's why I'm saying, grace was there. The gospel was in the Old Testament. But it was perverted by these same kinds of minds that came to the Galatians and tried to get them back under all these rules and regulations and laws. Paul says, tell me, those of you that want to be under the law, have you ever heard the law? Let me paraphrase Paul. Tell me, you who are trying to be saved by doing the law of Moses, haven't you read that Moses wrote other things where he wrote elsewhere?
Right.
And then he points them to what else Moses wrote.
Mm-hmm.
Genesis chapter 15 through 17.
Yep.
The whole story about Abraham, Sarah, Ishmael, Isaac, right? He points them there, and the reason is to show that it was never God's intentions that sinners be saved by their own best efforts.
Right.
It was never the plan of God.
Right.
It was always that He would be their Savior.
Hallelujah.
He did it by using Abraham's two sons to illustrate two ways of salvation. Now, in Galatians chapter 4, verse 22... For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a bondmaid, the other by a free woman, right? So the mother of the first son, Hagar, is a slave. Her son, Ishmael, was born according to the flesh, the result of foolish human reasoning and sinful human effort. The mother of the second son, Sarah, Abram's wife, gave birth to Isaac, the result of God's promise.
Right.
Now, Paul called the two births an allegory or a symbol or a living parable for two ways of relating to God.
Mm-hmm.
The birth of Ishmael is this vivid illustration of relating to God by using the best human effort, the best human reasoning. And so the Ishmael is human effort apart from the divine promise. Got it? Ishmael is a symbol of man's helping hand for a helpless God. It's a symbol of man saying, God can't do this, I'll have to do it. And the birth of Isaac, then, is an illustration of relating to God by trusting in His promise alone. Isaac is a symbol of a man's helplessness and then reaching out for divine help.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
All right, look at verse 24. For which things are an allegory? For these are the two covenants, the one from Mount Sinai, which gendereth the bondage, which is Hagar. Okay, so Ishmael's way of relating to God is similar to the covenant from Mount Sinai,
right,
coincidentally called Hagar by the Arabs,
mm-hmm,
which is his mother, Ishmael's mother.
Right.
On the face of it, as I said, it looks like Paul seems to be saying that when God entered into this covenant with Israel at Sinai, He was initiating a fleshly way or a Hagar way of relating to Him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the people of Israel were to bring their best human effort, best human reasoning, right? Based on that surmising. But if that's what Paul was teaching here, then of course it's no wonder that he could describe the Sinai covenant as bondage. But Paul wasn't looking back at the Sinai covenant and portraying it as legalistic and bondage.
Right.
He was looking at the way most Jews of his day had misunderstood it.
Right.
Amen? They misunderstood the original graciousness of Sinai, that covenant, and they perverted it into a covenant of works resulting in bondage.
Right.
Now, in case you missed that, there was a little rumble. That actually was a theological bomb. Praise the Lord. Well, for me it was. What I'm saying is, God intended grace, and he revealed grace in the covenant with Israel at Mount Sinai.
Right.
It's actually a gospel key.
Come on.
Now, it's the Sinai covenant. If that covenant, if that Sinai covenant of the Old Testament is a legal covenant, a covenant of do this and live, then we can forget about finding Jesus and his salvation in the Old Testament, which he tells us you can find. It's everywhere there.
Right.
Forget what Jesus and Peter taught. Forget what Moses and Abraham taught.
Mm-hmm.
If that's what Paul's telling us. But if it's a covenant of grace, a covenant of believe and be saved, then this is a key to seeing Jesus on every page of the Old Testament. The Sinai covenant is a revelation of Jesus' salvation by grace.
Yes.
Now, let me give you just a few quick arguments for this. First, the Sinai covenant shows a picture of grace. The moral law of Exodus 20 was preceded by the grace, think about this now, of the Passover lamb. What came first? Grace.
Yeah.
It was concluded by the covenant's ratification, the way it was ratified, through sacrifices. Amen. Followed by the gracious provisions and acceptance of those sacrificial animals in the ceremonial law.
Mm-hmm.
So even the law is trying to show us a picture of grace. I'm not saying it's not the law. I'm saying the purpose for the law was to reveal grace.
Yes.
That's what Jesus said. Moses, everything Moses taught was teaching of me.
Right.
We've talked about the tabernacle and the furniture and all the things and the way it points to Jesus. But I'm saying even the laws were all pointing to the grace of God. It was all God's intent to do it by grace.
Yes. Thank
you, Lord. God bookends or brings together this obedience that he required with multiple pictures, sermons, parables, however you want to describe them, of this coming suffering Savior. Every lamb that was slain, every bullock that was butchered, everything. This was the suffering Messiah.
Yes.
That Jesus said, they preached me. They were preaching the gospel of grace.
Yes.
Okay, so then another argument would be the Sinai covenant is set in the context of grace. Now, let's go to Exodus chapter 19, verses 4 and 5. The covenant is actually set in the context of grace. So Exodus chapter 19, verses 4 and 5. Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians. This is God speaking. Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians and how I bare you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself. Now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. So here you've got set forth in this particular scripture all that God had done in delivering Israel from Egypt as a basis for, therefore, obey me.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, don't obey me to get me to do something. Obey me because of what I've done for you.
Right.
And what does he say in obey me? Just accept the covenant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Accept my grace. I did this by grace. He did all that before there was anything.
Yep.
Amen? So redemption brought Israel into a relationship with God, which they were to respond to with gratitude.
Yes.
Just be glad. Be happy.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? Rather than obey and you'll be brought into relationship with me by a great redemption, it was, as you've been redeemed and brought into a relationship with me, here are some rules that will help you live longer, stay safe, and be healthy.
Yes.
He'd already redeemed them. They weren't doing that to get redeemed. He'd already redeemed them. And if that weren't enough, God underlines it again in Exodus 20, just before he gives the moral law. In verse 2 of Exodus 20, I am the Lord your God. Relationship, right? I am the Lord thy God. That speaks of relationship. He's talking about the relationship. Amen? Who brought you out of the land of Egypt? Redemption. I saved you. I have relationship with you. I saved you. So before he ever said anything about you shall or you shall not, he already said, I've got a relationship with you. I've redeemed you.
Hallelujah.
It's grace. He's talking about it's grace. It's the new, it's the gospel.
Yes.
The law was given to people whom God had already redeemed. Amen. Grace comes before the law. Now, if you go back and study this, you'll find there's 18 chapters of salvation before you get to Sinai and the Ten Commandments. 18 chapters of God saving.
Yes.
Now, here's another. The Sinai covenant points to our need for grace.
Yes.
In Galatians chapter 3, let's look at verses 6 through 9. Even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the Scripture foreseeing that God would, now look at this, the Scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So then they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. That's what I was talking about in the very beginning. Paul's arguing here that the law wasn't intended to disannul the promise of grace. But then he goes on to prove that the gospel of Moses was also a gospel of salvation by grace through faith in Jesus. Look at Galatians 3, verses 15 through 17. All that I'm saying is that God has always extended grace. God has always been a God of favor and of grace. That God has always loved us. That God has always wanted to redeem us. That he hasn't changed. From Genesis 1 all the way through Revelation, it's a God of love.
Amen.
A God that's reaching out with favor, with grace, with redemption, with salvation. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men. Though it be but a man's covenant, yet if it be confirmed, no man disannulleth it or addeth thereto. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not unto seeds as of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ. Amen? And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of God in Christ, the law which was 430 years after, cannot disannul that it should make the promise of none effect.
Mm-hmm.
So, Paul's arguing, he argues it from an ordinary human experience in verse 15. He says it's like a man. Amen?
Right.
Let's go back there just quickly. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men. Though it be but a man's covenant. Yet if it be confirmed, no man disannuleth or add thereto. So he brings it to him on this, on a human level, and he shows him just through an ordinary human experience, and the implication is obvious. Whatever the Sinai covenant did, whatever it did not cancel or change the saving promises of grace. It couldn't. All right, look at verse 21. Is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law. If the law doesn't cancel, if it doesn't change or even oppose the Abrahamic promises of grace, what purpose does it have? Apart from revealing grace through the pictures of grace and the context of grace, it also points to our need for grace. Mm-hmm. So when we think, see, the law got perverted, but the purpose of the law was good.
Yeah.
It was to show us God's grace,
yeah,
to reveal his love.
Yeah.
But it was perverted by man.
Uh-huh.
And that's the argument that Paul's making here to the Galatians.
Right.
So what purpose does the law serve? Well, it was added because of transgressions.
Right.
Till verse 19. Wherefore then serveth the law? He's asking a question. It was added because of transgressions till the seed should come to whom the promise was made. And it was ordained by angels in the hand of a mediator. It was to point them to the fulfillment of all these prophecies. If they'd understood the prophecies.
Yes.
The law was good.
Yes.
Because it showed them grace. The context of it. What came before, grace.
Mm-hmm.
All that led up to it, grace. Even the context of it itself is pointing us to grace.
Yes.
It was to bring us to see the desperate need for the promise. And to lead us to the promised one.
Yes.
That we might be justified by faith.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
The Sinai covenant, when it's understood correctly, was a revelation of grace. Or to put it another way, it was the gospel of Abraham, which was the gospel of Moses. And both of them were the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus preached. That's what Paul preached. That's what Peter preached. I don't have time tonight, but that's what John preached.
Yes.
When Paul attacked the Sinai covenant, he wasn't attacking it as it was designed by God.
Right.
But as it had been twisted and abused by the Jews. Which is exactly what Jesus was doing over and over and over and over in his ministry. That perversion was Jerusalem's main religion when Paul was writing.
Yes.
And it brought people into bondage.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now let's look at Galatians 4:30 and we'll quit with this. That's why he says, nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son. This perversion of the law. For the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. In other words, he's saying, you can't have mixture. You cannot mix law and grace. It's grace, period. Everything about the law was about grace, except for the way it had been twisted and perverted. Amen?
Yes.
That's what Paul taught. That's what Peter taught. That's what John taught. And most importantly, it's what Jesus taught. When you've seen me, you've seen the Father.
Thank you, Lord.
This grace message comes from the Father.
Hallelujah.
Every good and perfect gift. He's not just talking about, you know, our automobiles and our houses and the latest fashion. every good and perfect gift. The grace is a gift. Salvation, it's a gift.
Yes.
Every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, meaning he doesn't change.
Right.
He's the same yesterday, today, and forever as Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus didn't come with a new message.
Right.
Jesus didn't come as a better God, a nicer, more friendly, approachable God. He came as the very God of creation.
Yes.
Exactly the same. When you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I only do what my Father does. I only say what my Father says.
Mm-hmm.
So come boldly to the throne of grace.
Yeah.
It's always been God's plan to save. It's always been God's plan to give us favor. It's always been God's plan to heal us and deliver us.
Yes.
I mean, that's part of the revelation that David had. He sent his word and healed me and delivered me from my destruction. David saw the gospel in the Old Testament.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
He saw Jesus everywhere. That's why his writings are so profound today.
Yeah.
And you look at the other people and you think, my God, what were they thinking? He just had a clear understanding of what God was saying. The other prophets were searching and digging and trying to find what's the completeness of this? What's the clarity in this? They understood God was coming, that there would be a Messiah, that there would be an anointed one, that he would be the Redeemer. But they were more interested in when and how than they were the who.
Uh-huh.
But Jesus said, every one of them preached me. And when you get that, when we get that settled in our mind, then everywhere you look in here, you'll see Jesus and you'll see a good God.
Thank you, Lord.
You'll see that the gospel is being preached. Jesus is being revealed through every character in the Old Testament. He's being revealed through every situation and every circumstance. He's being revealed in every conflict. He's being revealed in everything in here, because you search the scriptures and they are about him.
Yes.
But let's look at it in the light of the gospel.
Thank you, Lord.
Not from the perverted religious perspectives that have twisted and misrepresented God to an extent that we don't know him when he shows up.
Right.
Because he's too good.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
Jesus is just all right with me. Praise the Lord. Jesus is just all right with me. Amen. And then some. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Amen, amen, amen. He's a good God, and we're not, that's just not a, a cliche. It's a fact.
Amen.
He is a good God.
Amen.
All the time, everywhere, for everybody. Praise God.
Amen.
God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Come back to see you Sunday. Have a good week.
What's left of it?
Praise the Lord.